Hey folks! Today we're talking about democratic citizenship education, which is the third moment in Engaging Minds. We left off authentic education talking about how it doesn't really critique what is or isn't in the curriculum, and this is something that starts to come in within this moment. In democratic citizenship education, we acknowledge our learners' unique histories as we did in authentic education, but we're taking this one step farther to consider how our learners' interpretations and our own as educators exist with those of others in an ecosystem of coherent thought and action. And here learning is understood as being embedded in cultural contexts, including norms and prejudices that come with us, and economic systems and inequities. So before we go on to critiquing the curriculum, we need to make an epistemological shift. So you know what that means? We're going back to the epistemology tree. So here we're looking at the intersubjectivity branch again, which is focused on humans, including the language and other symbol systems we use, and culture and personal identity. And we're starting off on the structuralism branch again. So this branch is concerned with how knowing and truth emerge from dynamic relational structures among people, words, ideas, and practices. And while we talked about constructivism last week as being a leaf on this branch, another leaf that is on this one actually is social constructivism. And Engaging Minds mentions that probably the most cited person in this area when we're talking social constructivism is Lev Vygotsky, who we talked a little bit about in our Introduction to Learning Theories module. And Lev Vygotsky was a psychologist in the Soviet Union. And fun fact, he was actually homeschooled until he was around 15 years old. And in his work, he discusses how individual knowledge originates in social interactions and only later becomes internalized as individualized knowing. So put simply, most mental functions start out between people before they become part of an individual's thinking. For example, learning how to talk starts off with mimicking and parroting our parents. And teachers and parents nudge learners to more sophisticated understandings of their worlds. And as we've discussed before, zone of proximal development is something that Vygotsky is very well known for. So the actual developmental level is what our learners can do right now, unassisted on their own. And the zone of proximal development is what's too difficult for them to do unassisted at this time, but with assistance, they can learn how to do this. So what was once the zone of proximal development can become the actual developmental level. And the process through which educators support students in this is called scaffolding. And unfortunately, Vygotsky died in his late 30s from TB, so he never got to see how widespread his ideas would become. And he commented near the time of his death that he died like Moses at the summit, having glimpsed the promised land without setting foot on it. And his work didn't reach the English-speaking world until the 1960s, and there was already a pretty established social constructivist literature out there available in English at this time, so his work was kind of absorbed into this body of literature. And educational recommendations informed by Vygotsky tend to recommend project-oriented and group-based classroom structure, especially those that emulate practice norms within and around particular cultural activities. So here, teaching isn't about imparting knowledge, but rather engaging our learners meaningfully in the application and possible extension of established knowledge. So here, teaching is more about enculturating our learners into specific communities of practice. Now, as I've mentioned before, democratic citizenship education is very concerned with social justice. But as you can see, social constructivism, and indeed even communities of practice, which is another leaf on this branch, doesn't really get into the social justice aspect so much. So where does this come in? Well, for that we need to make another epistemological shift. Well, the idea of social justice really came to be on people's radars in the 1800s. So remember, at this point we've entered into an industrialized world. We have factories, and the trademark has expanded, and a great deal of wealth has been generated at this point. However, this wealth isn't going to the working class that actually is working in the factories. Most of it is staying with the nobility, the people who are now part of the new upper class, like merchants and bankers and the like. And as we discussed in standardized education, there were also children from poor socioeconomic backgrounds working in these factories. This exploitation was more widely discussed and eventually made it into the entertainment of the era, like Oliver Twist in Les Miserables. And formal education here came to be seen as this great equalizer, this idea that it was going to provide all children with these different opportunities. And for some this is true, and for others it isn't. And many children tend to end up occupying the same social sphere as their parents. So often the advantaged stay advantaged and the disadvantaged stay disadvantaged. And this is still a problem. And a really great book that talks a lot about these issues is Dan Zuberi's Schooling the Next Generation, Creating Success in Urban Elementary Schools. And he does a really nice job of covering kind of what this looks like in modern elementary schools. And in the mid-1900s, people started to recognize that rather than challenging some of these inequities that were happening, school was actually helping to perpetuate some of these ideas. And so here we saw another epistemological shift. So post-structuralism, another branch on our epistemology tree, is really an elaboration on structuralism, and is more concerned with issues of power. Discourses in this area are concerned with the implications and complications of those claims to truth that come to be taken as the truth. And there's a lot of different things that fall under this category, like racism, sexism, classism, but they all have something in common here. And that's that they share a tendency to be critical of the conventional school as an agent of enculturation caught up in the perpetuation of existing social orders. So here we really question schooling and its complicity in maintaining an economically stratified culture in which the middle class, middle-aged, married, white Christian male is seen as being the norm. And so here teaching is about empowering, liberating, emancipating, giving voice. It's really about making the familiar strange. That is, we're questioning what it is that we take for granted as being normal. For example, white privilege and male privilege can be maintained through creating a curriculum centered around the work of deceased white males. So take the clip of Mohawk Girls I shared, for example.
Are we going to explore Native philosophy at some point?
Native as to?
Native as in Aboriginal? All the philosophers in the textbook are white. What about the wisdom of my people? Or black people? Or anyone of any color?
Well, in this course, we study the greats, but I'm sure you can find something in Aboriginal or black studies.
Now, like I said, there's a lot of different theorists and a lot of different philosophers in this area, but I want to talk here a little bit about two different works. I want to talk about Michael Apple's Ideology and Curriculum and Paulo Freire's Pedagogy of the Oppressed. So in Ideology and Curriculum, Apple argues that the commonly held social constructivist approach to education is too narrow. Instead, he proposes a more post-structural approach to education and curriculum. And he argues that educators and knowledge are not neutral, and schooling can reproduce inequity and social control within society through the cultural capital that is both preserved and perpetuated by our learning institutions. And what's contained in the curriculum, including how it's taught and even how we evaluate it, has social and economic values embedded in it. So as mentioned in Engaging Minds, we're teaching more than just the curriculum. And we accept this cultural and economic reproduction of the social order largely due to socialization and hidden curriculum. So what is hidden curriculum? Well, from more of a sociological perspective, there's three types of curriculum. So there's our formal curriculum, our informal curriculum, and our hidden curriculum. So formal curriculum is what's formally in our curriculum that we're supposed to be doing. So it's the actually endorsed course curriculum, and it's largely what's taught in our classroom. So for example, in nursing school, that would be what's taught in our lecture halls and in our labs. Informal curriculum is more of the opportunistic, unscripted teaching that occurs. So for example, in nursing school, this could be teaching on a unit. And so this type of learning happens outside of our formally designated educational spaces. So rather than being in a classroom, it could be the hallway of a unit, it could even be in a staff room. Now, hidden curriculum is the unintentional and often unarticulated learning that socialize learners into a culture. For example, medical school has a socializing function. It teaches students the attitudes and behaviors that are supposedly required to play the role of the doctor well. And these practices and structures can inadvertently contribute to maintaining inequities in our society. And as Apple points out, the formal and indeed the informal curriculum and how we teach it has social and economic values embedded in it. And Davis also talks in Engaging Minds about how the official discourses are defined by the dominating class. And this serves the learners from that social class quite well, but it can preserve these inequities between classes, preserving stratification within society. Hidden curriculum makes inequity and ideological hegemony of the dominant class seem natural. So in other words, schools give legitimacy to certain types of knowledge, which makes the knowledge of the dominant class seem neutral. Now, another important book in this area, which I highly recommend you all put on your reading list, is by Brazilian educator and philosopher Paulo Freire, Pedagogy of the Oppressed. And this is a really foundational work in critical pedagogy. And this book is really an effort to help those who are oppressed take back their humanity, which has been taken by the oppressors. And he argues that this liberation needs to come from the oppressed rather than the oppressor imposing their own models of liberation or treating them as unfortunates. However, revolutionary leaders and subjects of this transformation also need to be critically self-reflective, so it remains a revolution of liberation rather than domination wherein the oppressed becomes the oppressor. And the oppressors who have dehumanized themselves too in the act of oppressing others also have a role to play in this liberation. So they need to be willing to really examine their own role in oppression. And true liberation and transformation, if successful, will extend to all people. Now, Engaging Minds talks a lot about Ferrari, but I want to talk about his critique of what he calls educational banking. In educational banking, Ferrari is talking about this idea of knowledge being imparted by someone who views themselves as knowledgeable, or the depositor, to these empty receptacles or depositories of those who they deem to be ignorant. Sounds a lot like standardized education, right? So he talks about how this stunts the development of a critical conscience, and we need to transform education so the oppressed, and all people, can be beings for themselves rather just being integrated into this patriarchal system. And he proposes instead problem-posing education as a replacement for this banking model, as it doesn't cater to the interests of the oppressor. And it's rooted in a mutual relationship whereby teachers and learners are critical co-investigators within the educational process. And Women's Ways of Knowing, who we talked about a little bit a couple weeks ago, also talks a bit about educational banking, but it puts more of a feminist spin on it. So in this book, the authors talk about how some teachers get trapped in this banker role despite their efforts to avoid it, and how some students will actually gravitate towards it. And they suggest this could be because often the educator's thinking process is hidden from the student's view, so the learners are only seeing the perfect airtight argument rather than the incredibly imperfect process leading to it. For example, these videos, while they may seem most days seemingly somewhat coherent, they do take me a lot of time to develop, and there's a lot of outtakes. So the authors say that students may find it hard to find the courage to engage with these seemingly perfect arguments, possibly leading them to think they're incapable of producing such impeccable thoughts themselves. And the authors talk about educators as being a midwife teacher, so an educator who would support learners in drawing out or giving birth to their knowledge and ideas. So we've insinuated this a little bit, but let's talk a bit more before we sign off here about what this actually means for our learners. So here, it's important to note that in democratic citizenship education, the learner isn't seen as being deficient like in standardized education. And it's also not a matter of sufficiency like in authentic education. Rather, Engaging Minds talks about these learners being incomplete and biased. So what does he mean by this? So it's incomplete in that we're all part of this planetary web of knowing that is made up of dynamic and dependent relationships with all other people. And we're biased in that our expectations, beliefs, and assumptions are rooted in our own unique but culturally embedded histories. And we're bringing these biases or prejudice to our actions. So as educators, we recognize the importance of this unique history as we started to get into an authentic education. But we go farther to consider that our learners' interpretations exist with those of others in an ecosystem of coherent thought and action. And it's important to note here that something can seem right and sensible on an individual level, but wrong on a societal level, and vice versa. And as teachers, we see this as an occasion to negotiate understandings and collectively interrogate how different assumptions led to different conclusions. And our goal here isn't to reconcile conflicting different understandings, but rather we're trying to enlarge the space of understanding. And that's all for now, folks. I hope this was a nice little philosophical primer for you before we go into the next couple of videos. So my next one, rather than doing my normal, you know, getting practical, we're going to be getting critical. And we're going to be critical of some of the books and resources that we use in our teaching. And then the week after that, I'm going to be talking about the residential schools and the ongoing legacy in Canada. Please let me know if you have any questions, and I will see you all online.